Góðan daginn og ég býð ykkur all velkomin hingað í dag á fyrirlestur sem að William K. Black, prófessor frá Bandaríkjónum mun, eða dósent öllu heldur frá Bandaríkjónum mun flytja hér á eftir og mig langar til þess að kynna hann stuttlega fyrir ykkur en hann er associate professor sem undur því að sem dósent við háskóla, eða Missouri háskóla í Kansas City í Bandaríkjónum. Hann starfar bæði við viðskiptadeild og lagadeild þess háskóla og hann hefur verið sérfræðingur í efnahagsbrotum og hann hefur verið ráðgjafi á ýmsum sviðum og þar á meðal hefur hann komið fyrir þingnefndir Bandaríkja þings nú nýlega í málum er varða ætlaða refsiverða háttsemi þeirra sem stýrt hafa bönkum og öðrum fjármálastofnum í Bandaríkjunum. Þannig að hann er kærkomin gestur að mínum dómi hingað í Háskóla Íslands til þess að ræða og það sem hann mun ræða hér í dag er refsi ábyrgð þeirra sem stýrðu bönkunum vegna þess hruns sem að við höfum urðum öll vitni að haustið 2008. Hann kemur hingað á vegum samtaka fjárfesta og eins á vegum viðskiptadeildar og lagadeildar Háskóla Íslands og eins og ég segi það er okkur mikill heiður að fá hann hingað til okkar til þess að fjallum þessi mál. Sjálfur heiti ég Eiríkur Tómasson og er prófessor við lagadeild Háskóla Íslands og ég er fundarstjóri hér á þessum fundi og fyrirkomulag fundarins verður með þeim hætti að gestur okkar mun ávarpa okkur í það bil 40 mínútur og að þeim fyrirlestir loknum gef svo færi á að beina til hans fyrirspurnum og sem það er gert á ensku eða íslensku, við munum þá reyna að þýða þær fyrirspurnir yfir á ensku. Professor Black, it's a great honor for us here at the University of Iceland to have you as our guest today. I have already explained that you will today you will focus on the criminal liability of the persons that were leading the major Icelandic banks before their fall in 2008. And I have already introduced you to our guests here today and after this I would like to give you the floor, please.
So of course I want to thank the University of Iceland, the Shareholders Association and Vili who has brought me back. But mostly I'd like to thank you, and you can see, looking around, the people of Iceland do want accountability and are willing to make sacrifices to bring that about. And that is the primary requisite for dealing with these kinds of crises, because this crisis is not bad luck. The big three banks were not victims of external forces. The big three banks destroyed the Icelandic economy. And if they had continued past 2008, they're growing at roughly 50% a year. That means you double in size every 9 months. So think of the big three banks continuing another 2 years and being four times as large when they failed, an even larger percentage of losses than the two-thirds losses that they had. There would be no Iceland. had that happened. The losses would have been so enormous that the largest export of Iceland would be Icelandic people. And as Icelanders left, the burden on those that stayed would become hundreds of thousands of dollars per person. And they would have left as well if they could. So these are banks that not only destroyed your economy, they came within a hair's breadth of destroying your entire nation. Oddly enough, Dick Fuld running Lehman saved you. The world is stranger than we can conceive. I want to start out deliberately not with Iceland, but with a little historical retrospective, because I want to emphasize that what I'm saying is something we've been saying for over 25 years. It was not created new for Iceland. We have been warning about this for a quarter century now. And it is time for people to listen, because it's really expensive and really destructive when they don't listen and they produce disaster after disaster. So control fraud is where the people who control a seemingly legitimate organization, like a bank, use it as a weapon to defraud others. And these control frauds, as individual institutions, like these big three banks, or like Enron or WorldCom, produce greater losses than all other financial crimes, property crimes, combined. Just a single large loss. And they're virtually not studied and virtually not dealt with despite that. So I will give you, for a fraudulent lender, the recipe if you're going to bake this cake. It's a real simple recipe. You grow like crazy. You make really, really bad loans that have higher interest rates. We call that yield. You have extraordinary leverage. That means you have an enormous amount of debt compared to your supposed capital. And you put on pitifully inadequate loss reserves. Now, to skip forward to Iceland, if you have read any reviews of the report, you know that all four of those elements were present and indeed dominant at each of the big three banks. They were textbook cases of accounting control fraud. What's critical to understand is that the same recipe that produces guaranteed, mathematically guaranteed, notice how strong a statement I'm making, mathematically guaranteed record profits, if you follow that recipe, will also produce guaranteed catastrophic losses. It is the same thing that produced the fictional earnings that produced the real catastrophic losses here in Iceland and elsewhere. When you create a criminogenic environment, you get a lot of these frauds. What makes for a criminogenic environment? Well, many things, but the two biggest are when you destroy effective regulation or never have it, and when you allow compensation for professionals and for executives that is unrelated to performance, and that in fact becomes deeply perverse and creates strong incentives to create the fictional profits for professionals to create massively inflated values, and allows the individuals at the top to pay themselves to convert firm assets to their personal benefit through seemingly normal corporate means, all blessed by the professionals they hire. So the top-tier audit firms, the rating agencies, will all bless all of this. And that makes it very close to a perfect crime. And that makes it all the more critical to stop it. As these frauds begin, the people at the top use compensation to create these perverse incentives. For loan officers, for example, would be put on commission, where they would make their money based on not loan quality, but loan volume. Rating agencies would be put in competition with each other, and whoever was the weakest, the most immoral, was willing to give the most inflated rating, that's where the business would go. That is called in economics and criminology a Gresham's dynamic, where bad ethics drives good ethics out of the marketplace. And if you allow that to occur, not only do you produce economic catastrophe, it means that your most elite individuals are disproportionately corrupt. And they will use that power and that wealth to corrupt others. And that, of course, includes politicians most prominently. Also, when the defining element that separates fraud from other crimes is deceit. And what deceit means is I first produce trust in my victim, and then I betray that trust. And as a result, there's no more effective acid for destroying trust than fraud, especially fraud by your most elite individuals. And that, too, has happened. And that can cause markets to shut down, but trust is also critical in personal relationships and in politics and in social cohesion. And so as a society sees its elites engage in deceit, in cheating people, it loses confidence in those institutions, and some portion of the people respond by having their morality fall, and you get disaster not simply in economics, but in many other ranges. I mentioned that this has been written a very long time ago. It became a standard part of the economics literature in 1993 with George Akerlof and Paul Romer. Now, George Akerlof subsequently was awarded the Nobel Prize in Economics in 2001. So this is one of the best economists in the entire world. And he's not known as an ideological type. He's, we would say, an economist's economist. Think of the importance of this title: looting, bankruptcy for profit. It was a very carefully chosen title. It got across one of the central things that people don't understand, and that is the failure of the firm is not a failure of the fraud scheme. The people running the fraud walk away from the radioactive crater that they have left as wealthy individuals, vastly wealthier than they would have been. And they whine and they cry about how much supposed stock value they lost. The stock value never existed in reality. It was the product of the accounting fraud. So it's not like they could have grabbed 300 billion euros or something. It was never there, folks. These banks were never record profit-making institutions. That was always a fraud. Iceland was never the wealthiest nation in the world or near to it. That was a fraud. Right? And it's critical to understand. That's why the title of my book is The Best Way to Rob a Bank is to Own One. Again, written long before the Icelandic crisis. But you have shown the testament to that. Clearly, the best way to rob an Icelandic bank was to own it. So we have this superb theoretical and empirical support from economics, from criminology, and from regulators who dealt with these frauds in the savings and loan crisis back in the early 1980s, over a quarter century ago. It's time that we learn those lessons. I'm not going to concentrate on this, but since I have you as an audience, and white-collar criminologists rarely have an audience, I'm going to take 60 seconds to say, I'm going to talk about financial problems. But control frauds also maim and kill. Indeed, they're among the largest causes of people being maimed and killed in the world. So let's give you some examples. In Chinese infant formula, you probably remember this one, and you probably remember lead in Chinese toys for children. In infant formula, it is cheaper to have water than milk. That's the fundamentals of the fraud. And if you put talc powder in, it looks like milk. China looks for this kind of abuse by having a test that looks at protein levels. So you add melamine, because melamine spoofs the protein tests. You now have a product that has zero nutritional value and a contaminant that causes kidney stones in infants, killing at least 6 and hospitalizing 300,000, according to most estimates. There are people in the world who will kill your children for a few won. And there's nothing special about Chinese in this regard. And notice that private market discipline becomes intensely perverse because of the Gresham's dynamic. The cheaters prosper. They gain a competitive advantage, and in China, they drove all honest providers of infant formula out of the market. The New York, to show that this isn't limited to China, a New York inspector has just pled guilty and said that he falsified the information on lead and asbestos. If you understand lead and asbestos, you understand that he put at risk, again, all kinds of lives, and again, particularly children. Turkish building inspectors. Turkey has very good seismic codes. They're modeled on California. But Turkish modern construction commonly collapses in an earthquake, because it's cheaper not to put the rebar, the steel reinforcing rods, in the concrete. And it's cheaper, even though you have to bribe a building inspector for a few pennies to be able to do that. If you go to Vietnam at various places, don't buy your anti-malarials there. Studies have shown 45% of them were fake. They're cheaper not to put in real ingredients. And so the fakes tend to drive the others out of the marketplace. Blood diamonds are probably infamous, but they're still traded. They're just traded under false certifications that they're not blood diamonds. And you get fake certificates to get hardwoods that are not supposed to be harvested. And I won't say anything about Danes. All right. It's not just those third world types engaged in these things. In the savings and loan debacle, we too had a national report on the causes of the crisis. And this is what they said. The typical large failure grew at an extremely rapid rate, achieving high concentrations of assets in risky ventures. Every accounting trick available was used. Evidence of fraud was invariably present, as was the ability of the operators to milk the organization. That means the people at the top, to be able to loot the organization. That series of frauds in the United States was followed by the Enron era of frauds that nobody doubts were control frauds as well. There was over a $6 trillion loss in market capitalization. A trillion is 1,000 billion. We're talking about numbers that none of us can really comprehend. That's how large. It led to all kinds of alleged reforms where there was no input from white-collar criminologists, and they didn't address the causes, and as you've seen now, it didn't prevent the next crisis at all. But it did lead to Greenspan deciding to goose the money supply, which was a factor in the crisis. Now, we have this background. We have Nobel Prize winners warning about this fraud mechanism. We have criminologists warning about this mechanism. We left, I was a senior regulator, where we formulated these theories. So that wisdom is supposed to be there. You would think if you were going forward that people might learn something. At least in the United States, we have this saying, hindsight is 20/20. Is that a phrase, something similar, Icelandic? It means when you're looking backwards, supposedly you always get it right. 20/20 is the way we judge vision. It's allegedly perfect vision. So the idea is when you look back, you know the facts, you have perfect vision. We should be so lucky. In fact, people fit entirely because it's inconvenient. Because we in the United States, and I think this happened in Iceland, who became our great heroes? On the front cover of our magazines, our newspapers, in the talk shows, it was the CEOs who produced miraculous earnings and transformed our nations and our money centers. Felt good, didn't it? Remember those days? So, we forgot all about it. And we forgot all about it even though the FBI, the Federal Bureau of Investigation, arguably the premier law enforcement entity in the world, testified in front of Congress openly in 2004, a long time ago, that there was an epidemic of fraud, their words, and predicted that it would produce a financial crisis if we're not dealt with. That's about as good as it gets, right? And nothing was done by the prosecutors, the regulators, or the industry in response. Well, that's actually imprecise. What was done is they made it far worse. They took all of those recipe items that I talked about, and they put them, we would say, on steroids, right? And it became the complete triumph of the anti-regulators. President Reagan famously said, government isn't the solution, government is the problem. Well, if that's true, then regulation is the problem. And that's true, you destroy regulation. Well, they did. An article came out today in the United States that shows that the key regulatory agencies filed zero criminal referrals to the FBI during this period. We filed thousands of criminal referrals in the savings and loan. We got over 1,000 priority felony convictions. These are senior people, 1,000. But these regulators see no evil because they know that these people are the heroes and they know that regulation is illegitimate. So, because we have no criminal referrals, we have no convictions, no indictments, not even an arrest of any of our senior officials involved in our frauds during our part of the crisis. Instead, this is what we got. The grinning fools, as I call them. The gentleman from your perspective, on your left, is Chainsaw Gillerin. And Chainsaw Gillerin is holding a chainsaw. The three people next to him are the three leading bank lobbyists in America, or were at that time. This is 2002. And the other guy will become his successor, the successor of Chainsaw Gillerin, right? And they are over a pile of federal regulations, and the idea is to demonstrate their intention of cutting through and destroying all regulation. Well, mission accomplished. And we now know what kind of disaster that produces. And this agency, of course, has filed zero criminal referrals on anybody, not even tellers. Just like, what's fraud among friends? Real regulation can work. I told you about the convictions, but let me tell you about another episode that is almost completely unknown. In 1990 and 1991 in the United States, the same non-prime lending activities that blew up the United States recently were started. And we killed them by regulation. And there was no crisis. In fact, I don't think there was a single failure of an institution because of it. Now, it caused hundreds of millions of losses. Hundreds of millions of dollars used to be a number people cared about. Now it's, you know, we talk trillions. But you can succeed as regulators because we knew the indicia of fraud and we cracked down. Now in the United States, finally, and I'll be brief on this, we've started to look. We looked at Washington Mutual, the largest bank failure in U.S. history. And it is a textbook case of accounting control fraud. We looked at Citicorp, and their guy in charge of credit on mortgages testified that 60% of the loans they sold were under false representations and warranties. That he pointed this out, including writing a letter to this guy who used to be our Treasury Secretary, Mr. Rubin. And the action in response was so vigorous that when the credit guy looked again, he found that the percentage of misrepresentation had gone up to 80%. WaMu, when it did internal surveys of fraud in its operations, found fraud percentages in its mortgages above 80% in the shops where it looked. Can you imagine that? Lehman Brothers was the largest purveyor. We call it a vector, for it spreads the epidemic, in the world for non-prime loans. Lehman had a subsidiary that specialized in making what the industry called liar's loans. Now, how hard is it, folks? Do you really need grad school to be able to say, I don't think liar's loans are going to be a good idea. I think they're going to be a disaster. People had business plans where all they did was liar's loans. So they have to have somebody who's supposed to look at quality. This poor guy actually looked. And of course he found fraud everywhere. So he made a referral to the FBI. The FBI came to his place, which is called Aurora. Aurora is the goddess of the dawn, right? In the Greek, this is Dawn of the Dead, if you've seen those kind of movies. And so he tells them the frauds that they've found, because that's what you're supposed to do as an anti-fraud guy, to inform the FBI so they can stop the frauds. Aurora fires him for violating its privacy policy. Then there's Goldman. You've heard enough about that in the press. I won't go through it. Rating agencies. There have been two reviews. And the documents that have come out are incredibly embarrassing. I mean, they did whatever was needed to give AAA ratings to the most toxic stuff. Well, literally liar's loans that they knew were liar's loans. They called them AAA. We also looked at Fannie and Freddie previously, and we found wide-scale accounting fraud at both of those places. So that's seven of the largest financial institutions in the world. We've looked at seven, and we found fraud or obvious abuse at seven. Maybe we should look at some of the others. Iceland has looked now at its big three. And this report is excellent on large numbers of facts. Indeed, the irony is it is such a good report on the facts that we know that the conclusions are often wrong. But we would only know because they were honest about finding the facts. But you will see, at least in the English, and I believe this is going to be true in Icelandic, you're not going to find any citations to any of the criminology literature. You're not going to find people hired who knew criminology. You're not going to find citations to a Nobel Prize winner who wrote about the fraud mechanisms. You'll see other people cited, other economists, but no one looked, even though they were supposed to look. So I'm not saying they should have indicted people. They can't do that. They didn't have to write up this particular individual committed a fraud, but they were supposed to look at why do we have these problems. And instead, they substituted euphemisms and denials that are actually going to make prosecution more difficult. So they should stop that. We should be blunt. We should be honest and not screw up the potential prosecutions. So, what did we find? Remember the recipe. Grow like crazy. Well, mostly they're growing at 50% a year. Again, that means you double in size every 9 months. Second, they were really good at making bad loans with high yields. Third, their leverage was essentially infinite because their capital was fictional. And leverage is it's a concept in which you look at a ratio to capital, but the capital was not there. We have a joke in the United States, you know, that when you get to Oakland, you find out there's no there there. When you went to the big three banks, capital, you found there was no capital there. And the loss reserves were a sick joke. I mean, why they bothered to put the pathetic few krona in is almost beyond belief. But of course, it was a sure thing, just as all the models, all history has shown. They followed the recipe, so they reported record profits that were completely fictional, and they produced catastrophic losses that were real. And if they'd have been allowed to go further, they would have made even worse ones. But sick implies that it's just bad luck. The situation in the international financial markets in the autumn of 2008 has been described as the perfect storm. It was under this situation that the three Icelandic banks collapsed at the beginning of October 2008. The implication is, if you don't have a storm, they don't collapse. They grow 50% a year. So they're twice as big in 9 months. And they grow 50% the next year. And they're now four times. And they're making bad loans all this time with no loss reserves. So tell me, folks, what does that have to produce? Vastly more catastrophic losses. Somehow that has disappeared. And what is this supposed perfect storm? The perfect storm was, hey, they needed liquidity. Boy, that's something that a bank could never figure out. And they used a gambling metaphor. As the winter of 2000-2008 progressed, the banks were very dependent on their, that should be on their, but that's in the original, on their share prices and largest debtors. Rather than hanging on to their liquid assets, the banks provided substantial amounts as loans for own shares and to support their principal owners. Kupthing, in particular, loaned large amounts for the purchase of own shares. The banks were betting everything on life. Okay. So the idea is that we're supposed to be surprised that in a liquidity crisis, where cash is precious, they voluntarily use their cash to purchase shares or to fund the purchase of shares, because that's insane, right? If you have a desperate need for cash, you don't throw the cash out the door purchasing things you don't need to purchase. You might infer from that if their behavior is irrational for an honest firm, that they might have done it for another reason. Why did they have a desperate need to keep inflated the share price? Well, we know the answer because of the commission finding. We knew it. You know, we thought we knew it before, and we were right, says the commission. Because they were loaning on the basis of share price, and so they had to keep the share price inflated, and because they were paying all kinds of people in shares, and so it paid to inflate the share price. And therefore, the survival of the firm, again, the firm fails. Looting, bankruptcy for profit. Bankruptcy is the failure of the firm. They knew the firm was going to fail. They didn't know which month it was going to fail. They were going to try to keep it in existence longer so they could loot more. But they knew it was going to fail. And in the end stage, they kept, of course, using capital in completely irrational ways for an honest firm and completely rational ways for a control fraud. Now, it's this last sentence, though, that I want you to particularly focus on. The banks were betting everything on life. First, banks don't bet. People bet. CEOs bet. Banks are inanimate. They don't have minds. They don't suffer from greed. These decisions weren't made by banks. They were made by CEOs and their cronies, the owners of the banks. The best way to loot a bank is to own one. Second, they weren't making a bet. They knew exactly what would happen if they took cash that was critically short in a liquidity crisis and used it to purchase shares. That's not a risk, folks. You know exactly what's going on. You know exactly why you're doing it. You know exactly how irrational it is for an honest firm. So the betting is a disastrously bad metaphor that their defense counsel are going to use if they are ever indicted. And they weren't betting on life, even if you think they were betting. They were betting on death. They knew they were going to destroy the firm, but they don't care. They walk away fabulously wealthy, and they keep the Ponzi scheme going as long as they can, and they had to buy shares to do that. And then we have more of the bad luck. This is an American economist. Any firm's failure reflects some combination of bad luck and bad management. In other words, he's just defined away fraud, control fraud. It's not bad luck. It is certain that the firm will fail. They had spectacularly good luck, folks. This was a wonderfully benign environment with generally very low interest rates. Rating agencies willing to prostitute themselves for mere hundreds of millions of dollars. They had good luck, spectacularly good luck. So this kind of sentence just drives me to distraction. Here again, this is written in two, should read 1994, not 2004. The citation at the bottom. This was written a long time ago about the savings and loan crisis, and it makes the point. Accounting abuses also provided the ultimate perverse incentive. It paid to seek out bad loans because only those who had no intention of repaying would be willing to offer the high loan fees and interest required for the best looting. It was rational for operators to drive their institutions ever deeper into insolvency as they looted them. And so you seek out your buddies, your cronies, and you loan at high, actually pretty high interest rates in many cases. And what do you do when they can't repay, folks? You refinance the loans. Exactly so. I talked about this Gresham's dynamic. Again, this is back in 1993. Abusive operators of SNL sought out compliant and cooperative accountants. The result was a sort of Gresham's law in which the bad professionals forced out the good. These frauds go to the most prestigious auditors in the world because that reputation is valuable to them in their looting, just like they go to the top rating agencies. The cover-up phase. The report details a lot of very old scams used in the savings and loan crisis to self-fund capital, to self-fund loans, and refinancing. It produced guaranteed profits, fictional, and guaranteed destruction of the firm. The saying in the U.S. industry is, a rolling loan gathers no loss. You just roll it over and roll it over. And I think that that is a good place to break for question.
I just want to make one remark here, being an Icelandic lawyer. When the parliament decided to establish this committee, parliamentary committee, it was stated in the respective law that the evidence, the reports that they were giving before the committee couldn't be used as evidence in criminal proceedings. That's why I think the committee refrained from drawing conclusions, but of course it is for our prosecutors to do so and thereafter our courts. But what is important, I think, in the report is that it was a fact-finding mission, in my opinion, a very successful one. But it's just the beginning. Now we will ask our audience for questions, and there are many hands, I can see. I would ask everybody to be concise, short in their questions. And the gentleman in the row three, as well. Would you like to stand up and present yourself? And if you have questions in Icelandic, I will try to translate them.
Thanks, Mr. Great lecture. My name is Mar Mixa. I'm interested if you have seen any similarities in the current crisis that is from your perspective, sort of perspective, to maybe the dot-com bubble, Thailand, Nordic countries, 1980s, etc., the Roaring Twenties. Are there any particular similarities? Of course, the Ponzi scheme was in the 1925, something like that. Are there any certain similarities occurring during all those crises?
Yes, I mean, one of the similarities is accounting fraud as the weapon of choice, we call it, in each of those. Is this mic on?
Yeah.
Okay. So in the Southeast Asian crisis, you had, of course, it's kicked off by the Thai central bank lying about its foreign reserve position. So fraud can exist not just in the private sector, but most assuredly in the public sector as well. Thereafter, it's really a story in large part of their crony capitalism network, where there were all kinds of fictional entries, and it didn't matter that you were had business had failed as long as you had one of Suharto's relatives or cronies on your board, you'd be bailed out or the accounting rules would be ignored. In our dot-com scandal in the United States, similarly, it became very common to gimmick the quarter-end numbers. And we have all kinds of phrases for it, like channel stuffing, where you would purportedly sell a bunch of stuff to purchasers the day before the quarter ended. And so that would show up in revenue. And then, of course, you would either buy it back or it would be returned because they had the right of return and such. So, yes, accounting scams are the favorite weapon, and that is globally. The checks, have a wonderful phrase for it. They call it tunneling, where you take it out of the legitimate enterprise and sort of goes underground through some different avenues and ends up in the owner's hands.
Thank you. Whether you think that the fraudulent activities might be more inherent within the banking sector, both private as well as central banking, as Murray Rothbard, economist, described as not as fractional reserve banking, but as fraudulent reserve banking, and indeed characterized central banking as legalized counterfeiting. How would you respond to that?
Well, I don't agree with the Austrian economists on many things, and that's one of the areas that I don't agree with them on. I think a gold standard, for example, which is where they tend to end up, is a wonderful device for causing recurrent financial crises, and that's what it did over time. So I think they romanticize the past when they talk about the gold regimes.
Mike?
For a wonderful lecture. Now we're all here.
Yeah. Please tell your name.
Nick Alcott. Now we're all here. But who would have been here in February 2008? Our problem is, and we have sort of detailed this kind of problem with respect to the American example, our problem is that there was no way to bring these issues to the serious attention of the public, to the serious attention of the parliament, to the serious attention of whatever regulatory agencies we have, to the serious attention of the media. I think nobody in Iceland probably imagined the depth of the fraud, but plenty of people knew that there were things going wrong. And we have a systematic way of turning all of this attempt to get these issues discussed and to get something done about them, if it turns out that there has to be something done about them, diffuse it, to ridicule people, to ignore them, to issue phony reports like the Michigan report. I wonder if he's somehow liable in this financially. And so on and so forth. So since that's part of what you're, a large part of what you're talking about in the UN, did you comment on that? Is there any way? I mean, there are lots of other disasters on the road. And if there's a meeting about that tomorrow, nobody's going to come.
Yeah, so two things. One, there was no public outcry at all in 1990 and 1991 when we stopped the non-prime scams in their infancy, if a mere $200 million in losses can be considered infancy. But that's early enough to prevent any crisis. So if the competent regulators believe in regulating and understand fraud mechanisms, even if the public isn't outraged, you can stop them before they gain enormous political power. So to take the non-prime, what happened next is that they went into a non-regulated sector. Some savings and loans, which were regulated, changed their charter to become mortgage banks so that they would no longer be regulated. And the most notorious predatory lender became the largest political contributor to George Bush. And we made him our ambassador to the Netherlands. So once they get powerful, if they're not stopped early, they can cause enormous damage. More generally, yes, neoclassical economics creates environments that are very fraud-friendly. And we need to take up that on more generally, Portes and Michigan just being examples of that.
Thank you, Mr. Black. My name is Sjöfn Hjartarsson. Thank you for coming to Iceland and help us open our eyes. Just a few days ago, a standing committee in Althingi, the Icelandic Parliament, made an agreement on an investment contract with a company named Vern Holding, where Novator, a company owned by Gjörgulsson owns a, well, share to a large extent, actually. I would like to, I'm troubled with this, but obviously we need some court investment here in Iceland, but I'm troubled that Parliament is agreeing on an investment contract with one of the former owners of Transport Eastwood.
Ah.
I'm troubled with this, but I would like to have your outside view on this.
Well, I would not have made Mr. Arnall our ambassador to the Netherlands. I would have put him in prison. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, hi. My name is Pia. And from what you were saying, I gather that everything is like a huge conspiracy between the lawmakers, between the business people and everything. Now, my next question is, like, how can we protect ourselves? How can we, the people, believe that the regulators and the lawmakers that presents our voice is actually doing the right thing to prevent this thing from happening again? Because all these banks, they're operating internationally. They are imposed by the International Accounting Standard Board, and we are joining EU in sometime in the future.
Well, I don't think so.
Well, maybe, but we're going to be imposed with EEA regulation, with international regulations as well. They're all supposed to be very, you know, believable and justifiable.
Okay. So, first, it's worse than you think, because it doesn't require any active conspiracy. Right? People don't have to get together in a room. If I put my loan officer on a commission based on volume, I don't have to say, in the United States context, John, I'd like you to make bad loans. Lots of them. I just give you a compensation system that means that you will do that. So you don't ever have to have the formal conspiracies that you fear, and you can still get many of these results. Now, I will tell you a story in our context, because, you know, what do I know about Icelandic politics? But in the U.S. context, those things that we did, we re-regulated the savings and loan industry during the heart of the savings and loan crisis, where it was growing, the frauds were growing at 50% a year, and we stopped that dynamic while they were still reporting record profits and no losses, right? So that was a very different thing. The Reagan administration hated us, threatened to make a criminal referral for prosecution of the head of our agency because he was allegedly closing too many insolvent savings and loans. A majority of the House of Representatives co-sponsored a resolution saying don't go forward with re-regulation. Five U.S. senators who became infamous as the Keating Five tried to block it. The White House attempted to appoint two members to our three, our agency was governed by three people. Two of them attempted to appoint who were chosen by the leading savings and loan fraud in America. Right? The Speaker of the House tried very hard to get me fired. Keating wrote famously, highest priority, get black, kill him dead. Right? You know what? We just went forward. We just went forward and did our duty. Now, we're not employed in the federal government anymore, you may have noticed. And the Obama administration doesn't come and ask us what should we do to crack down on these things. But we don't have any problem in our house avoiding mirrors. We're quite willing to see ourselves still.
Would you say that's what we need? We need an independent body to prevent this thing from going on, apart from the law enforcers and law regulators, sorry.
You need Vikings to be Vikings, okay, as Vikings once were.
Okay, there are a lot of people that have asked to put forward questions, and I will try, please be patient, I will try to see to that everybody can pose their question, but please be concise and just one question per person. Yes, sir.
Mr. Bach, thank you very much for telling us this saga. We all knew about this, but we needed to be confirmed from somebody. Not from the island, from Holland. I know you don't like to speculate, you want to have your facts clear. But can you speculate a little bit about why the special prosecutor doesn't want to hire you now?
Well, in fact, I met with the special prosecutor and his senior staff yesterday for what was supposed to be an hour-long meeting, and it went at least an hour and a half. This is the second meeting I've had with them. We worked together extremely productively. Right now, they get my services for free, so I think that... I think the answer as to why they don't hire me is pretty clear.
Two very good questions. When did, and from the meeting, see when the point is being started? And secondly, what do we have to do to control our regulator? How to regulate the regulator?
Well, I just came from talking with your regulators for an hour and a half before this meeting, this discussion, and this is the follow-up. Last time I was in, I briefed the entire staff for over an hour, and this time we met with the entire senior staff that was in the offices. So first, I think you have an excellent head. This is someone who recognized just how bad these people were and resigned when they were going to take over. I think Iceland has done exactly what the United States needs to do. Hire people with a track record of integrity. Right? You need competence, but more, you need integrity, and you need courage, and people that could care less about party. Four of us regulators met with what became known as the Keating Five. Again, Keating was the most infamous fraud. He had five U.S. senators doing his bidding, and they were trying to prevent us from taking an action, right? And we stood up to them. To this day, I do not know what political party my three counterparts belong to.
The first question. When did this start?
It started, it looks from the evidence like it started immediately. It got progressively worse, which is the normal pattern.
Meaning that it's essential?
Yes. Yeah. As soon as this ownership group came into power, full power.
Gjör svo vel hérna.
Thank you for your lecture. You talked about the big three, referring to banks. We also have another big three in Iceland. We have big three auditing firms. These three gave the banks a health certificate right up to the middle of 2008. In your opinion, did they do it because they didn't know any better, or was there some other reason?
No. Iceland was an easy one to figure out, just like liar's loans are easy to figure out. If you loan your own capital, you're going to be a fraud. It's not weak capital, it's fictional capital, right? So the same problem exists all over. The earlier gentleman asked what was a common element, and I said accounting, and it would be the top-tier audit firms giving clean opinions to massively insolvent entities. And so this is done, this is why I put up the slide about the Gresham's dynamic. You put these firms, actually you put their partners who want to bring in business in competition with each other. And the art is that you don't defeat controls, you suborn them. You turn them into your most valuable allies. And that was exactly what was done. As I said, in the United States, we recovered over $1 billion in the savings and loan crisis from what was then the Big Eight accounting firms in the U.S. context.
Most firms are still not in the banks.
Yes.
My name is Adrian Ritrenson. I understood from, thank you very much for your excellent lecture, but I understood from it that basically the international monetary crisis had come as, came as a blessing and saved Iceland from, or saved the banks from expanding much more heavily, and we could have ended with $1 million per every woman and child as an ISAFE liability if I had the...
Another five years.
So it seems to me that you are sort of rewriting history, because we had thought that the international crisis was destroying the Icelandic economy. Do you think that, for instance, the terrorist act that was imposed on the banks by the British government was also sort of a blessing to save us from continuing on this deadly road, so that the Prime Minister, who is going into an election in a couple of days, he was actually our benefactor?
Gordon Brown benefactor. It just... It is hard, isn't it? But yes, and something similar happened in the United States. In 1986, the tax laws were changed, and we had had a lot of really stupid provisions in that caused you to do uneconomic construction. And those were removed in the 1996 bill. And that did help break a raging financial bubble in commercial real estate. Now, that seemed to people at the time like it caused losses. In fact, it dramatically reduced losses because it popped that bubble, which otherwise might well have expanded for another 2 to 3 years.
Yes, hello, thank you very much. My name is Jonina. In the year 2003, I wrote a book called Tombstone Iceland. And I got threatened by lawyers not to publish this book, besides nobody wanted to publish it, because the pressure was so great. We've had a few white-collar crime cases in court in Iceland. Maybe you are aware of that. And in all or in most severe cases, the court judges four white-collar liars. And this is an issue that I would like to bring up here, because I can see there are people who have been affected here that have taken part in business, which is not wrong, but don't dare to get out with the information they have, because the court system in Iceland is totally incompetent in judging these cases. So should we go on spending a lot of money on these cases, knowing the results from the highest court in Iceland? Thank you.
So there is a historical precedent for this as well. The person who created the concept, white-collar crime, was an extremely distinguished person, the head of the American Sociology Association. And he wrote a book about these crimes of the elites that had public information about they were convicted in this state and such. No one would publish with the chart showing the elite firms convictions for over 20 years. So they removed it from his book so that it could be published. And it, as I say, it took over 20 years for a full publication of this to occur. Now the answer to that is, the only way to fix it is to go forward. And if they're going to rule against you, make them rule against you. But we do things like this, communication efforts. I would suggest training, where the judge, we do this in the United States, come in, talk to academics, not about a particular case, of course, but about how control frauds work, right? So that they understand these kinds of fraud mechanisms. Expose them to a Nobel Prize winner in economics, so that they just don't say, well, no, I mean, he couldn't have meant to do something evil, right? I mean, surely he didn't take money from the account, move it to two different accounts, never tell anyone, but he really was doing it to help the customer. You have to expose this insanity, and the only way to expose it is to go forward. And then there have to be consequences to the judges when they adopt insanity.
My name is Jon Einar Jakobsson. I'm a lawyer in Reykjavik. And I want to thank you first, Professor Black, for an enlightening lecture.
Good. I was afraid you were going to say you represented that individual.
Not yet. And my question it's not a cynical question, it's more serious. But by reading the report from the investigative committee, parliamentary committee that it has been recently issued, we may assume that politicians took part in the bankers' crimes, either by negligence or even willingly. Now, since the politicians were fully supported by the parties, respective parties, would it, in your legal opinion, be reasonable to consider the political parties as crime organizations? This is serious. Absolutely. Not on the same level as the Mafia or Murder Incorporated in Italy, but with the same principles.
Okay, so I survived Charles Keating, and I'm now supposed to commit suicide here? I'm just stupid enough to go there. Okay, so I am told that the Icelandic portions of the report do have loan size of members of parliament, and that these loan sizes in many cases are astonishingly large. That is certainly worthy of investigation. Let me not generalize about political parties that I know very little about. But I do know about fraud. And yes, people, the saying, and this is not cynical, this is an empirical statement, in the United States was, the highest return on assets is a political contribution. And you can make contributions through loans that never get repaid.
This is the second time, thank you. My name is Anna Atopoulos. I would like to ask you, do you think that the Americans have a lower tolerance for fraud now? One would have thought that after Enron they were more aware. Do you perceive that they were not more aware, and do they have the same level of tolerance for fraud? I mean, we have a very
Actually, there are very few societies that have a tolerance for fraud in truth. In other words, if you go to a very corrupt society, corruption is not popular. People in that society hate corruption, hate the elites that gain power and maintain power through it. So the United States, fraud makes you despicable. And when we do studies of humans almost everywhere, by the way, we show that. In economic terms, we over-deter against fraud. We'll spend $3 to recover $1 because we are so outraged by the betrayal of trust. Remember I told you about the role of trust. So in the United States, what you saw was the triumph of an ideology that literally said, I'm quoting now, or virtually word for word, a rule against fraud is not necessary or particularly important. They believed fraud could not exist in markets after all of this history where it had been the primary cause of the failures. Now that's significantly insane. And all of our top regulatory leaders were appointed because they were willing to believe that nonsense. That's why you have Chainsaw Gillerin at the top. That's why they were proud of that picture into the annual report of the FDIC. You can go online in the 2003 annual report and see it. Those people too often are still in power, but the American people hate fraud. I went through that recently. There have been disclosures of frauds at our most elite institutions. That is changing things in the United States, where people are starting to use the F word. And that will make possible more prosecutions.
My name is Ragnar Önundarsson. One party to the problem is foreign banks.
No.
But they were not an issue in the White House. So, but they were funding the Icelandic bubble, and they were funding the Icelandic fraud scheme, to use your wording. And that was an easy one to detect, you said that before. Now, these foreign banks, they were also using the same recipe. It was growth, it was bad loans, it was high yields, high leverage, no research or little, and record profits. So they were guilty of the same. We are now collecting money from the bankruptcy estates, and they are expecting to pay these remains to banks. Listening to you, I think we should not pay them as a donut. We should establish good case against them and hold them liable for the damages which they have done. They're supposed to be specialists. They are supposed to be specialists in banking and economics, etc. But still they funded the millennials.
So let me respond. Two things.
Okay.
My
final point is, are you willing to be our lawyer in this point?
Fortunately, I'm not an Icelandic lawyer, so I can't bring any court cases. Two major things from your point. First, the economic theory that I just gave you, that fraud couldn't exist, that markets self-cleanse immediately. The premise of that is called private market discipline, and it is expressly those banks that are supposed to exercise the private market discipline. That became an oxymoron, because what they did was fund the frauds, not discipline the frauds. And as you say, they likely engaged in it themselves. In some contexts, that can establish in the United States liability as what we call an aider and abettor of a fraud. And if you look at our Enron crisis, we have a report of a bankruptcy examiner similar to the report you in Icelandic, very long, and it details how every major bank that Enron approached facilitated them scamming the accounting rules and knew that's what they were doing. And they paid billions of dollars collectively because of those frauds and had their claims against the bankrupt estate denied because they had aided and abetted the fraud. So, yes, there may be a serious legal point to exactly what you say, but it's certainly not for me to present it.
My name is Björn Plattner. Do you think we need a Glass-Steagall Act in Iceland, an act that would separate investment banking from commercial banking, as there was once one at a time in the United States before it was diluted? That's my first point. The second, I'd like to follow up on what the two ladies in the front row were saying, that the Icelandic penal system appears very weak. I predict that very few people in Iceland will ever go to jail because of this. And I say this also to irritate the prosecutors who are in the room, many of whom I see, because Iceland has never been very good at prosecuting white-collar crime. They're very good with burglaries and drug crimes and the fisticuffs, but when it comes to financial crimes, it gets too complicated for the prosecution, and that's what we will end up having.
Tell me what the first one was again.
Do we need a Glass-Steagall Act?
Glass-Steagall, yes, thank you. Yes, every nation needs a Glass-Steagall. There is an inherent conflict of interest between commercial and investment banking. And the answer of creating so-called Chinese walls never works in practice. So yes, that would be a good thing, not just here. Now, I don't think it's much the prosecutors that are the problem. I think it's the judges that are the problem in Iceland. And the only way to fix that problem is to put the facts in front of them again and again and again in the most clearest fashion you can as to why this only makes sense if it's a fraud, And if, in the worst world, they rule against you, then you have to use that to go to your parliament and say, we need real judges, because we don't have real judges.
It's the law that's weak, not the judges.
Well, maybe in the cases that I've heard about, like the recent one in the non-embezzlement, where you embezzle, but it's you really wanted to help people. And so that's okay. That's not a weakness in the law. That's a weakness in the judicial understanding. And that's too much sympathy. I mean, your broader point is the one that Sutherland, who coined the term white-collar crime, talked about and why he emphasized elites. The problem with many judges is they just cannot conceive of someone who is well-dressed being a criminal. Now that has no basis in reality. But that class idea has to be broken. And so before you appoint new judges, ask them questions. Find out, get people with a track record of understanding and caring and being willing to do justice for everybody, including elites.
Yes,
and scream like hell when they abuse it.
Let's not wait. Let's do it now.
My name is John Dieter Horenbaum. I thank you, Professor Black, very much for your presentation. There is no doubt in my mind that your presentation will definitely be very valuable and help us with dealing with the past. But the past has left us in a term. And we are living in that term of love. And it is not less important to deal with the present situation that has been created. The people are speculating, is it possible that the new owners of the bank might be some of the same that owned them before and are buying them behind their back? We don't know. The great number of companies that went back are in the hands of the bank now. And they seem to be distributing these companies. And we wonder what will happen. Are we creating another situation now that is really a new company that you have to discuss a little about this situation?
Sure. The phrase in the United States is the best disinfectant is sunlight. Some translations of the Bible phrase it is all those that doeth evil hateth the light. So transparency, I mean extreme, ultra transparency. And that doesn't start just with the regulatory agency, it is in the disclosures. If you want to be running an entity, you have to disclose everybody that has any interest, any side deals you have, any oral deals you have, any understandings you have. Ask it as broadly as necessary. Make all that information public. There's no reason for that to be confidential. And then have what you hear are engaged people, engaged press that ask tough questions, is willing to criticize people. Last time I hear we talked about it as the third cousin problem. It's a small nation. If I gather a staff of 20 investigators, anybody I investigate will be at least a third cousin of somebody on my staff.
The last question here.
My name is Kristin Mahler, Microsoft. How can we make sure that our new banks have a social, environmental, and ethical responsibility policy that they follow?
Oh, well, right until they follow, I had an answer. Enron had a wonderful ethics policy, I'm serious. It had nothing to do with reality on the ground. I would settle for banks that just tried to make money, honestly. Because you haven't had that. And that's sort of my first requisite. After that, you need governmental policies that are going to guide the banks. You can't rely on a bank to be green. You know, so if you need green things done, do that by regulation. But concentrate first on fixing the banks, because you have just seen how devastating they can be. And I'm dead serious. 2 more years, there was no more Iceland. The nation would have collapsed, in my belief. And now, I'm largely Irish. You will perhaps recall that the population of Ireland remains one half of what it was over 150 years ago. You can have enormous depopulation. And that's one thing if you start with 8 million. But if you start with 320,000, it's a very different thing.
Yes, I would now like to draw some conclusions of what we have been discussing here as a law professor. I think that the Icelandic judicial system, we will see within the next 4, 5, 6 years whether it will be up to this duty to sort out these things. I am not so pessimistic in the judicial system as many of our distinguished guests are here today. But I have been maintaining for a long time, for several years, that our judicial system has lacked resources. And nobody listened. The prosecution authorities, they have not had any resources to deal with all these economic crimes in the past. That's the main reason why the Icelandic judicial system has not been as effective as it should have been. And this was decision by our politicians. They didn't want the prosecution authorities to be strong here in Iceland. And they even didn't want our courts to be strong or independent. So these were political decisions that were made just in the same line as they didn't want our regulators, the bodies that regulated the banks and the financial institutions, to be strong and effective. So I hope that the political attitude will change here in Iceland, and if we give the judicial system, both our prosecutors, the police, and not least our courts, the necessary resources to deal with these cases, I am optimistic that we will deal with this as every other civilized nation will do. But I want to warn you all, we cannot sacrifice due process, because if we would do that, we would be even worse off than we are today. Because this has happened in history. We know all the terror that followed the French Revolution, for example, and that's something we don't want here in Iceland. What I have always maintained in my education in the law faculty is that the people that have committed crime, they should be judged and they should be punished. That should be the aim of our judicial system. If their guilt is not proven, we have to acquit them. That's the principle that we have lived with here in Iceland. People have lived with in the United States. and that's a principle we have to live with in a civilized society. Professor Black, it has been an inspiration for me and for many other people to have you here with us. It is encouraging to hear that you are fighting these types of crime, and I know that we have a lot of people here in Iceland that also want to join you in fighting these crimes in the past and also in the future. Before I conclude this meeting today, I would like to remind our guests that there is another meeting planned for tomorrow at 12 o'clock here at this same venue, and there Professor Black will deal with related issues, mainly how to recover the money that are lost. I heard him tell us a part of it. I heard from your interview in the Icelandic television on Sunday that, of course, some of these sums never existed. So they won't be recovered. But I think that's an interesting topic, and I hope to see at least some of you tomorrow as well. But I would like to conclude this by thanking our distinguished guest from America for his excellent lecture, and I also thank you all for participating here today. Thank you.